Hi, Michael. Hi, viewers.
Hello.
Greetings from Setu. Greetings from Toronto. We are back again with an illustrious artist of Los Angeles and a young rising star of the literary sky, Michael Rousselet. It's great
Hello.
pleasure for Setu to host Michael Rousselet, a Los Angeles native writer and painter, for the 8th episode of the limited series of literary and critical conversations. As you know, the journal has been at the forefront, highlighting the career trajectories and achievements of eminent creatives, their views on life and fine arts. Michael Rousselet is a well-known name with a significant social media presence. However, a quick introduction. Here it goes. Michael Rousselet, a Los Angeles native writer and painter, is a screenwriting graduate from the University of Southern California and is one of the founding members of the 2008 online comedy troupe, 5 Second Films, as well as the co-editor and director of the horror comedy feature, Dude Bro Party Massacre 3rd. Michael is a contributing writer for Cyanide and Happiness and Mad Magazine. Creator of Hatch, Sleep Therapy, Storytelling, Train of Thought, and one of the creative directors for Paramount on Scream 5 and 6. Rousselet has written 3 episodes of Shudder's Creepshow and has infamously been labeled Patient Zero behind the cult movement of Tommy Wiseau's The Room in 2003, when he converted the film's dismal theatrical performance into successful fan screenings, which are now performed all over the world. He's sorry, but not that sorry, he says. His philosophy of life is write from the heart and the laughs will follow. You can visit his YouTube website and his Instagram to see his paintings. On behalf of Setu, I extend to him a hearty welcome. Welcome to the 8th episode of the limited series of literary and critical conversations, Michael.
Hello, thank you for having me. It's such an honor. It means a lot. Thank you.
Well, to begin with, sum up Michael Rousselet as an artist and his range of works for our viewers.
Thank you. To sum up my work, I think it would be colorful and bold, either on the page or on the canvas. I'm a storyteller at heart, and I really just want to get people engaged. And the best way I know I can get someone's attention is by getting a laugh. When you screen a drama, you don't really know if it's working, if people are honestly connecting to it. Because someone could just always say, like, oh, yeah, that film was great, but did they really mean it? But with a comedy, you could hear the laughs, you know what's working, you know what's not working. So I tend to go for kind of the most surreal or outrageous kind of themes and jokes to kind of really make people engaged and usually with a raised eyebrow of like, what is going on? And with my paintings, I like to, make them bold and expressive and also hide little images in there, like a Rorschach painting. So you can look at the painting and kind of engage with it longer because you can see things come out. And Yeah, I just want repeat viewing. I want repeat watching, and repeat reading. So I want people to evolve with the work, to find new things, as they change and as the work changes.
So eliciting smiles and making people
Yes.
laugh, I agree completely. Isn't it rightly said that laughter is the sun that drives winter from the human face?
Yes, that's beautiful. I love that.
Yeah.
It's a powerful way to make friends, and you can disarm people by getting them to laugh. It's a way to release tension. It's very important.
It's kind of therapy, in fact.
Yes, absolutely.
Laughter is
Yes.
a therapy. Well, what's the concept behind 5-second films? Are there any overarching themes?
Well, so the concept of 5 second film started in college in 2007 at USC, and it was created by my friend Brian Ferenzi. We were both in a screenwriting program, and one of the teachers asked, "What did you do over the summer?" And everyone answered, and when it got to Brian, he said he made a couple 5 second films. And when I heard that, I was thinking, "That's absurd. What can you do in 5 seconds? That doesn't make sense." And this is in 2007, so there was nothing that short. So when he showed me some of the 5 second films he made, that it just clicked. It was so funny. It was ridiculous, outrageous. You can get in and get out before the audience even knows what's happened. It's like a live action comic script. And I would carry around this moleskin notebook. I would write all these notes and jokes and ideas I would have throughout the day. Unfortunately, now that I have a cell phone, I don't carry a moleskin anymore. I have my cell phone. It's not as romantic when you have a moleskin. So I had all these ideas for jokes and just like little odd observations, and I didn't really have a place to put them. And 5 second films was a perfect outlet to just have a creative like outlet for all these weird ideas. So we started making a new film every Monday through Friday. And we started the website in 2008. We started making a new film every Monday through Friday. We never missed a day for 6 years. So we made about 2,000 films.
Yes,
And we had a rising fan base we weren't expecting. Originally, we were just making it for ourselves and our friends and our family. And then we started developing a following. And then we were kind of committed and stuck with it. We said, okay, well, now we have to keep doing this for as long as we can. And we were lucky enough to get some comedians, famous comedians like Patton Oswalt, David Koechner, Weird Al Yankovic, other celebrities, Juliette Lewis, Greg Sestero from The Room, and even Larry King. We got interviewed by Larry King, and he said he'd do some 5 second films with us. It was we were Vine before Vine and TikTok before TikTok. We proved that you could do micro comedy. So we amassed like a quarter of a billion views in 5 years, which oddly enough it doesn't sound like a lot now compared to TikTok, because TikTok can ramp up a lot more. It was a fun exercise in storytelling, and I made a lot of amazing friends and met a lot of amazing people. And it allowed us to make our feature film. And for overarching themes, I guess it was pretty much whatever would make you laugh. The whole intention is just like, what's the joke? Can we squeeze two jokes into it? Usually it would be surreal. Sometimes it would just be an odd observation, but the whole theme was whatever can make you laugh, just let's try it.
Great. So these are teeny micro short films with comic as well as are there dreary themes as well?
Yes, there is some dreary themes. There is a we did an exercise just to see if we could do it. We called it Bummer Week, a very depressing week of 5 second films. There were no jokes. It was kind of situational observations and character pieces, and some of them were really, really sad. And it was once again the power of visual media that you could get so much information across in just 5 seconds.
5 seconds.
It's basically a
Totally.
painting. You could just, the way you frame something, the lighting, it changes everything dramatically. So yeah, the fans really enjoyed it because it was such a departure from what we would usually do. And I think that's a big, another theme with 5 second films is doing the unexpected. The comedy is kind of setting up expectations and either subverting them or delivering them. Yeah.
Surprising.
So, yes, it's all about a surprise.
Yes, so it retains the attention and it's so shorter span, so people really enjoy it. And no
And if it
testing
wasn't,
of their patience, no testing patience at all.
yeah. And if it's not funny, we just wasted 5 seconds of your time. So our original motto was 5 second films, wasting your time, but not very much.
Okay. So what kind of audience do you target through these shots, Michael?
People who are looking for a distraction, people who want something bizarre. Usually would gravitate to people my age who grew up with the internet, and younger audiences, people that have that quick attention span, people that can read something really quickly, like digest and process the information very quickly. But yeah, it's usually people who are just looking for weird, silly, random comedy, a little crazy.
Well, tell us something about comedy as a visual genre. Does its grammar undergo a change for film and television as a media of communication? Your views on that?
Well, comedy works best, I think, in a visual medium. It still works also in a text form, obviously, but I think there's something more playful and active. Well, no, not active, I wouldn't say. There's something more playful and, I don't know, stimulating to just see it come at you like that on a visual form, as opposed to, in a book. The book, you get to create your own visuals, but I think what you could always think of something, you could write something and then you can just visualize something absurd, like a penguin flying an airplane. But to see it and on in a visual form that someone took the time and the effort to actually get a penguin, put it in a cockpit of a plane, like you're like, you actually went the extra steps to do this, like the extra mile to be silly. And I think the fact that there's an effort into putting all these elements together and, like an absurdist set piece, like a play, as opposed to anyone could write it down and write the craziest thing, Godzilla does laundry and he shrunk his favorite t-shirt. You're like, okay, I could see it in my brain, but if you went out and you filmed that with a guy in a 10-foot lizard costume, like waiting at the dry cleaning, that would be amazing because you actually put forth the effort to do that. And there's something to be admired in making the effort. So in the visual media, I think it just lives so well.
Yeah, it's definitely very challenging format. 5 second films, too short a span to put your message across, that too through visual images. So very challenging, and it tests the intellect of the creator as well as the one who is watching it.
And it tests the savviness of the filmmaker to how can they efficiently and also cost efficiently make this possible. And like the secret ways you could cheat camera angles and with little visual tricks and effects, you can make it more feasible. You don't have to spend a lot of money. And there's something to be admired about the cleverness of doing a film shoot on a inventive and, you know, cost-efficient way.
And it caters to all age groups. This is also something very unique of 5 second films and comedy.
Well, I wouldn't say for all age groups. I mean, there's definitely a wide array of jokes that we do in 5 second films that might be a little bit more adult.
Oh.
But there is definitely something to be said about, we do have a lot of PG related and, you know, safe for work comedy. And that's something to be admired, where you can tell a bunch of jokes and not all of them have to be dirty. You can do some clean humor. Because it's so easy to just make a dirty joke, you know, to go to that just kind of naughty kind of type of humor. It's just, it's not as inventive, you know. It's kind of like a go-to, you know, you could just say fart and you know it's going to get a laugh. Because, but if you try to make a joke about a duck that is trying to steal bread out of a, you know, a bread factory, I guess you would call it a bakery, then, you know, there's more universal connection to the silliness of it. You know, it's innocent. It's like when a little kid tells you a joke. Like, the more creative and pure that joke is coming from a child, like, the funnier it is. You know, like a little kid telling a dirty joke isn't, it's like, oh, I don't know about that kid. Who taught you that? That's weird.
Great. You have written comedy and horror both. So how do you manage these two diametrically opposite artistic forms?
Well, I grew up loving horror. I think I loved it because growing up in the 80s, it was a little silly, you know? And I think that when you see someone get stabbed with like a rubber, and they're like a rubber doll, and it's clearly fake, it you kind of separate the realism from it and it becomes silly. So at an early age, I always thought that horror was funny. For the most part, you know, there's those rare, brilliant, truly scary films. But for me, I watched a lot of silly slashers. So there was always kind of like this world where they knew it was kind of like a wink, like a silly film. Mm-hmm. But when I write, if I know I'm going to be writing for a horror film or if I'm going to be writing for a comedy, I just kind of have to flip that switch in my brain, you know, day for night, of like what alleys of the maze of my brain are we going to go down to? Is it going to be the comedy section or is it going to be the horror section? Sometimes we get to overlap them, which is what I love, because horror and comedy are both about, you know, expectations, tension, and release. So you set up a scenario of someone walking down a dark hallway in a horror film, you have these certain expectations, you know, of tension, of like what's in that hallway, and then there's a jump scare, and then okay, then you can release, and like there's the scary. Same thing with, you know, walking down the stairs and you see a banana peel in a comedy. There's that tension and that expectation that they're going to slip on the banana peel. And then you have to subvert that expectation and deliver and release that tension. So they both deal with expectations, tension, and release.
Correct. Yeah. Quite antithetical when you said horror is funny.
Yeah. Well, a lot of the
That's a nice way of putting up.
I think that why horror is funny is a certain nostalgia of it. Like everything pre-1990 feels safe and silly. And then modern horror, because, you know, audiences are more clever and knowledgeable of, you know, horror films, that they have a better handle on how to, you know, mess with the audience and subvert expectations. And the makeup effects have become incredible, and the CGI has become really great, that you can make things look realer. So when there is a very gory scene or something, or it like hits you harder, who knows, maybe in 30 years it'll also be nostalgia and silly, and like all the Saw movies are just, over the top when they came out, but like 10 years later you can be like, oh, they're a little silly. I get scared when I see a new horror movie. I walk in thinking like, this is gonna mess me up, because I'm like, they know what I know, and they're gonna screw with me, and it's gonna be scary.
Yeah, but they are interesting. That is also true. Whether you really love horror films or not, but at least there's something that keeps your interest up while watching.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Well,
it
you want to see
keeps
where
you
it goes. You
yeah.
want to see what are you going to do that's different,
Yeah, it
like
might
what at like
be creepy, but still people watch.
yeah, it is one of the most successful genres, just on a pure kind of a profit return. It's hard to make money off of an indie drama, but it's a little easier to almost break even with a indie horror, because the horror community is very loyal and they want to just see every horror film that comes out. So it's a the horror community, it has more love, and I think is actually a very welcoming group. It's wonderful.
Yeah, so why horror goes so well with the film and TV audiences? You have already spoken about how there's enduring popularity for horror films. So anything you would like to add?
Well, I think with why horror is more popular with like film and TV is because you get to see the gore, you get to see the attempt, you get to see the filmmaker try to scare you. And in a book, you're reading it, and I think it's more active because now the reader is now creating the images in their head. And I think that a book can be scarier than a movie because it's the reader is the one who's allowing it to be as scary as their brain will let them have it.
Yeah,
Like, for
he's
example, if the.
sketching it in his, there are mental images.
Yes. And then, if there's an example of, like a dog comes out, like a rabid zombie dog comes out, that reader will now see the dog, but when they think of a scary dog, they're going to go back to a memory of what was a dog that scared them. It could be a German Shepherd that's scarier, or a Rottweiler, or a pit bull. That reader will now automatically click and say, scary dog, boom, this is what's scary to me. Because if you're watching a horror movie and it's like a scary zombie dog comes out and it's like a zombie corgi, I was like, oh, that's kind of cute, a little zombie corgi. But the writer can now kind of let the reader, hold the flashlight in the dark and see what they're going to point at. Like if they say a rotting corpse is on the floor, the reader will read that and they'll depict how gross they want that corpse to be. But in a movie, that rotting corpse could just be as good as the makeup effects team has on a tight budget. Or the lighting, did they light it too bright and now it clearly looks like a dummy? It's just the reader can now create those images and be as scared as their mind will let them get scared.
And that too
So
just
yeah.
in 5 seconds. So instant gratification. People
Yes,
would
that's
really
true.
love it. Yeah. In this
Yeah.
fast-paced digital world where there's so much of information overload, people have really lost their patience. And especially when it
Yes.
comes to reading, they don't like to do that. Most
Yeah.
of the
And
pictures are lapped up.
I feel bad. I feel like we kind of made it worse by doing 5 second films. It's all about attention deficit. You just want instant gratification. You want it now. Because reading a book is very active. You have to actively sit, read, and focus. And a movie is just passive. You can just let it kind of like just happen. You can have it in the background. But yeah, when I read, I need no distractions. Like maybe instrumental music playing in the background, but I can't be around with people talking. because I want to hear what they're saying. It's just, and it's so hard to find, like quiet time to read a book.
So, who are your favorite film directors? The directors that have shaped up your idiom?
So, I kind of went a little off the film path, and I incorporated some TV people that I like to talk about as well. Well, for film, I love Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton. Very silly visual medium. And
He's
also,
a world icon. Charlie Chaplin.
I love Charlie Chaplin and Buster Keaton. Just great comedy, great jokes, visual medium, show don't tell. And then I love Looney Tunes. I grew up watching the Looney Tune cartoons. It's just because the logic is so surreal and silly. It's just, a cat gets smashed and turns into an accordion. Just silly things. Like you didn't think that was possible. I adore Monty Python, also surreal silliness. The Holy Grail and Life of Brian. And then Mystery Science Theater 3000 was a huge influence on me because it exposed me to my love of bad cinema, and it showed that bad cinema can have value and importance. There's something fun watching a bad movie with friends who are along for the ride. And then growing up, as I got older, I started watching more art films like Luis Buñuel, surrealism. I loved Akira Kurosawa, Werner Herzog. I loved Woody Allen. I thought he was very kind of, Charlie Chaplin-esque, kind of silly, and some of his dramas. And then, of course, being a child of the 80s and 90s, I'm a product of Steven Spielberg and James Cameron. Jurassic Park was the movie that made me want to be a filmmaker because I was like, this is all magic. How do you do this? And for horror films, I love John Carpenter, Wes Craven, George Romero, Sam Raimi, and yeah, then the silly schlocky horror films of the 80s, like Friday the 13th Part 4, Nightmare on Elm Street 3, Child's Play 2. But yeah, just a smorgasbord of weird and silly.
Share with us some of the highlights of your career, especially about that part where you were labeled as patient zero. I would like to know the story behind it.
So The Room is this wonderful, horrible, terrible movie. It's brilliant. It's just a bad film, but it's so entertaining. And that's very rare with a bad film. Sometimes a bad film is just bad and it's kind of good at a few parts, but The Room was just nonstop, top to bottom, hilarious, engaging, just terrible. So I saw that in an empty theater in 2003 with two of my best friends. And before the movie was even over, I was on the phone calling friends, my little flip clamshell phone, calling friends saying, "You have to see this movie. It's terrible. It's brilliant. We're going to stay in the theater. We're going to hide for the next screening and we'll sneak you in the back door." So we watched it twice that night in the same theater and we snuck in 15 friends. They couldn't believe it. They were laughing. We were the only ones in the theater still. So we just kind of owned that theater and we were screaming and yelling and running amok. And then we said, we have to bring our other friends who couldn't make it because I was trying to call everybody and people were like, "I'm having dinner with my family. I'm not going to leave and go watch some crappy movie." So we said we were going to come back tomorrow. And they're like, "Wait, this is going to be the third time you've seen it?" Like, "Yes, you got to come." And so we saw it eventually four times in 3 nights. And at the end of it, we had 100 people. We brought plastic spoons and wore ties on our heads and threw footballs, and because we wanted to make it engaging, like a Rocky Horror Picture Show, mainly to make it fun for our friends who were the last holdouts who were reluctant to come. They didn't want to see a bad movie, and I promised we would make it worth their while. So yeah, we just ran amok, and then we kept bugging Tommy Wiseau for DVDs because it wasn't available, and when is the next screening? And this is before social media in 2003, so there was no Facebook or YouTube, Twitter. We couldn't, like, everything was grassroots. We just called friends and said, "You gotta come, you gotta join us." And so we watched it every time it would play. We would bring more of our friends, and then eventually it started to grow where there were strangers showing up, people we didn't know. And then Entertainment Weekly wrote a big, extensive article about it in 2008 by Clark Collis wrote it. And he interviewed me, and then he called me Patient Zero, and then it stuck. And so, yeah, and since I'm now labeled Patient Zero of a cult film, it sent me down this rabbit hole where I felt like I'm some sort of representative for bad movies and cult films. So I had to learn as much as I could. So I just started reading cult books and watching crazy stuff just to try to understand what that world was. Because I only knew Mystery Science Theater and Rocky Horror. So I didn't know that there was like a whole other universe, pink flamingos and stuff. But yeah, and then 5 Second Films came along, did that because we were all broke. It was in 2008 and we had no jobs because the recession just got right out of college, boom, recession. So we just kind of did 5 Second Films to keep us sane and sharp. And eventually we started getting interviewed by magazines and I got interviewed by Larry King. That was really cool. Larry King is in Dude Bro. We get to kill him. That was surreal. He said, he was interviewing us and he said, your next project is a movie called Dude Bro Party Massacre 3. What is this? What is this? And we explained it to him and he goes, that sounds really interesting. He goes, well, would you like to be in it, Larry? We'd love to kill you. And he lit up and he went, oh, I've been in 33 films and I've never been killed before. I would love that. Yes. And so we got him in our movie. We killed him. He was so cool, really sweet, great guy. But yeah, other highlights, I don't
Fascinating.
know. I got to write for Mad Magazine. That was an amazing. I'm in the last copy of Mad Magazine, like the last physical magazine that before they shut it down. So I like to joke that I killed Mad Magazine. My joke was so bad, they just said, that's it, we're shutting it down. And writing for Creepshow has been a huge honor. Yeah, writing with my friend Eric Sandoval, working on Creepshow, it's just such an honor. And Creepshow has this great motto where they say it's the most fun you'll have being scared. And I think that's just wonderful. So yeah, just I'm painting, I'm just kind of doing everything I can, doing the hustle.
Such exciting, memorable moments. They are just etched in your mind. And
Yeah.
so, very interesting. How does Los Angeles treat its writers and young actors? Is there some power dynamics at play there? So, what keeps a writer going, writer, actor, director, despite all this power dynamics at play?
Well, LA treats its writers and actors like disposable products. It's a very difficult industry. I think it's gotten even more difficult the last 10 years because decisions aren't being made for what's good and what would be an interesting story. Decisions are being made for what's good for the stock prices. It's more of a everything's a corporate decision. TV, actual TV, has become kind of bland where it's like, what's the most appealing for the most widespread audience? Streaming is just all kind of algorithms and demographics and studies. So everything is just being formed before, like you have to take your idea and you have to fit it in the form that each distribution model wants it to be. So it's just really difficult. But yeah, it's you just got to do it. You just got to keep writing and creating and auditioning and you do it because you love it. You have to accept that disappointment is going to be around every corner, and you also have to know when to say no to a job, because it's just going to, be free and take up too much of your time, and it might not be the right thing for your career. So, like, starting off, you say yes to everything, and then eventually you realize that your time is very valuable, and then you have to start being very selective of who you give your time to, because if they can't afford to give you a payable wage, then you have to think like, is this going to be a good use of my time? Because we only have so much of it. But yeah, you just it's just passion. You do it because you want to, and the dumb blind optimism, the hope that the there will be a next level to the ladder you can get to. Because I'm lucky that I'm doing much better than I was, 12 years ago, 15 years ago. But that's not, I'd still wish I was a little higher up on that ladder. But yeah, you just got to keep going. Hopefully, if I just keep doing this, all my competitors will be dead or move out of LA and I'll have no more competition. But no, you just have to stick with it forever and ever.
Lot of struggle. But
Oh,
yes,
yeah.
passion and persistence are the main drivers in such cases,
Yeah.
which keeps you moving and getting just to go
Yeah.
ahead. You have to maintain that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, moving on to your paintings, what are the recurring themes, motifs there that you aim to capture through colors?
So I like to paint. Painting for me is kind of like a left brain, right brain vacation. When I write, it's very, I can't remember what side of the brain it is, but it's very focused and you have to pay attention, you have to think a lot. Painting is more of just you can just turn your brain off and just explore. I like I said, I like putting images in there, like hidden in there, so you could see something every time, new every time. I've had friends and people have purchased paintings that say, like, I just noticed this dog. And I'm like, oh yeah, that dog's been there the whole time. You never noticed it. It's just so you could interact with it. It changes. I don't know. I don't like minimalism. Those paintings, I understand it was important when it came out. It was like a rebellious form of art, and like art always changes with the times. And but like I look at minimalism and I just go, ah, there's nothing interesting there. It's just, it just feels like corporate art. I don't know. It feels like it has no soul. But I don't know. But yeah, I like hiding things in there. I recently have been getting more commissions for painting images that that frames that are in movies. So somebody asked me to paint some Ninja Turtles, and I painted one, and then a bunch of people wanted all the other Ninja Turtles, so I painted those. A Gremlins painting. I'm currently working on a Stay Puft Marshmallow Man painting.
There at the backdrop, I see a few paintings. They must be yours.
Yes. Let's see if I can just move my camera over. Boop. Here are a couple of mine. Oh, hang on, leveling out. Here are a couple of mine. Like you can see that big blue one on the bottom. It's kind of like a giant skull. You know? Yeah, but there's a lot of stuff going on in there. All my other paintings are upstairs, and there's a bunch more. But yeah, every once in a while I'll get a commission for a giant painting, and I get to like make a big mess, and it makes me really happy because there's nothing more fun than just throwing paint on a canvas. And it's also just with abstract, you can make mistakes a lot, and you can just roll with the punches and just, like, oh shit, this didn't work out. Now I have to change it. Now there's a whole bunch of, green on the painting. Okay, well, now I have to figure out where this goes. And, but yeah, a painting is never finished, it's just abandoned.
That's wonderful. Your journey becomes enjoyable if your vocation becomes your avocation. And here it is like that. So march on. What has been your experience as a director? And why this focus on creep show?
So my experience as a director is I only like to direct things that I'm passionate about and I care about because it's very stressful to be a director. There's a you have to know what you want, and if it's something and if it's a story that you love, you know what you want. I've directed commercial stuff and educational videos and stuff that you just have to go through the motion. So you're like, I know what angles I need to get the information across, but there's no spark of magic. And that's what, as a good director, you're always looking for that spark of magic, that moment you captured on camera. So I try to focus more on writing because I can just create what I want and then let somebody else worry about it. I wrote that you needed 100 ducks in this scene, and now I only see five. What happened? I couldn't get 100 ducks. But yeah, it's I like Dude Bro Party Massacre 3 was a labor of love, and it was I loved 80s slashers, and I wanted to do a love letter to 80s slasher. So I knew what I wanted, and I had a wonderful, brilliant team. My co-directors were just my best friends. It was great. It was all a labor of love. And it was stressful too, because some things don't work out because of just the elements are always against you. But the elements are never against you when you're writing a first draft, until you sell that, and then the producer says, "Look, we can't shoot this scene with 100 ducks. Can you make it one gigantic duck?" And you go, "Okay, I guess I can make one gigantic duck, But yeah, directing is fun. It's very challenging. It's fun when it's something you like. And for Creepshow, that's just a dream. It's such a fun show. And yeah, it's horror and it's comedy, and it's amazing to see the end product. Like, you write something and then you see these professionals. Everyone is just on the top of their game and they're working hard. And you write about a giant bug creature and then you see them do it. And you go, "Oh my God, that is so much cooler than it was in my brain." And you're just blown away. It's such an honor. We actually have one more episode coming out in October of this year, 2023. So yeah, I can't wait to see what they do with that. It's going to be a trip.
I see. Okay, our best wishes for that to
Thank
you.
you.
Yeah. Well, anything else you would like to share with us?
I would say that watch bad movies. Just as much as you watch good movies, watch a bad movie. And I don't just mean like,
Oh.
a Michael Bay film. Like, I mean watch, Ed Wood, watch Tommy Wiseau, watch Doris Wishman. Watch a bad movie, because as a filmmaker, you can learn almost more from watching a bad movie than you can watching a good movie. A friend of mine put it, he's like, "When you watch a great movie, it's like watching someone ballet dance through a minefield and not setting off an explosion. When you watch a bad film, you watch somebody blow up every single spot, and you're like, 'Okay, don't do that. Don't go there. Don't do this.'" And I think it's just as important as watching a good movie. So
Correct.
yeah, watch bad films.
It's good advice. Is Hollywood listening?
Well, I don't know.
Has been a very engaging conversation, Michael. I wish you the very best for your future prospect. May you rise and shine. May you win awards for the work. Okay.
Thank you so much. It's an honor. It was very sweet. Thank you so much for having me. It means a lot. I thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, viewers. In the next episode, we will be back again with yet another important guest with us. Till then, bye-bye.
Bye.